Now it's time for the panel discussion session with the leaders from the BFSI, that is banking, financial services and insurance sector. The discussion in the BFSI is important as the major driving force for the growth of the IT security market in India. The panelists for the panel discussion sessions are Mr. Milind Warekar, CIO Saraswat Bank, Mr. Kapil Madan, CISO Minda Corporation, Mr. Upkar Singh, Director, IT, FIS Global, Mr. Pavan Chawla, CISO, Future Generali India Life Insurance Corporation Limited, Mr. Kapil Mehrotra, Group CTO, National Capital Management Services, Dr. Sindhu Bhakar, Co-Chairman and Founder, EST Group. The session is being moderated by Dr. Deepak Kumar Sahu, Chief Editor, VAR India.
Let's start the discussion. Let me brief about the discussion first. So today, can we start now?
Yes.
So the discussion is on latest strategies to deal with cyber threat vectors and latest trend from a global perspective. So let me introduce about the theme. Why you have chosen the theme is important. Cyber threats are a big deal. It's not small. Today, every business, regardless of its size, is a potential target of the cyber attack. Cybersecurity awareness needs to become a useful part of everyday organization's culture. It needs to be something that reaches us and is relevant in our homes as well as in our workplace. They can disrupt phone, computer networks, or paralyze systems, making data unavailable. It is not an extragression to say that cyber threats may affect the functioning of life as we know it. The threats are growing more seriously. True cyber security risks pervade every organization and aren't always under IT's direct control. Business leaders are forging ahead with their digital business initiatives. The risk of becoming the victim of cyber crime is becoming greater every day. The COVID-19 crisis has led to the majority of enterprises working from home. While the employees are working remotely, they've started using personal devices to connect to the corporate network. These devices are often very vulnerable, causing a major concern for enterprise security. On this backdrop, we have six panelists in the panel. So let me introduce all: Dr. Sindhu Bhaskar, Mr. Kapil Madan, Kapil Mehrotra, Milind Warekar, Pavan Chawla, Upkar Singh. They're the panelists. Now we are going to start the discussion. To start with, the first question is, cybersecurity takes center stage with the increasing sophisticated attacks, brings new security risks and challenges. How, Kapil, you are going to address this? Let's start with Kapil. Kapil Mehrotra.
Yeah. All right. Now these days, vectors are day by day getting very stronger. And the problem is that most of the organization, they are not ready with that change. If you talk in terms of the percentage, so in terms of the 70%, 60% organization, still they are not ready. This is one of the very big risk what I see is, and the kind of vectors they day by day is attacking to the organization. Where another issue what I am noticing it, the awareness. Still people are not aware fully, except few people in the organization. So this is one of the biggest threat what I feel so. And looking at these two big challenges, we have to look at to the right implementation partner to look for the right solution and the threats with what all the comings now these days. So third problem statement according to me is the budget. To get the budget from the management, it is another one of the big challenge. Reason is because they don't understand. You go to them and they ask what kind of prevention you can give and what kind of benefits you can give. Still, you have to negotiate with them a lot, especially with the finance people or your CEO or CEO. So what I feel is like these three, if we can mitigate these three things, like we can basically up to somewhat like we can secure to the organization. So this is what is my thought is.
Okay, good. So we'll understand from Mr. Pawan Chawla. Pawanji.
Hi, sorry. I second what Kapil has said, the threat has changed over a period of time. Now, ever since the COVID has started, so it has changed many things. One, it has changed the way we look at cybersecurity. Second, it's changed the way business does the business. Third, the way threat actor used to perform their task. Now, that has also gone into a complete change. Now, I touch base on each and every point and give a little insight here. Now, India was never used to be never used to have a culture of work from home. Now with COVID, that has changed drastically. Every organization today has this culture of work from home, irrespective of the scale and irrespective of the business they are into. They have adopted work from home culture. They have made sure whoever was not ready in the initial few days, they have made sure that in the later 3 months. Probably by June, I think each and every business was ready to handle such a situation. Now, by that, with that change, what change is the perimeter? Now, the perimeter security was used to be firewalls, routers, layer 3 switches and all. That has gone to the desktop level. When it reached to the end user machine, the security, the threat has become more prominent. Threat actors have become more advanced. The way they are now using techniques is completely different from what they used to do in the past. How this has changed, if you look at it in the last 3 years, there are organizations who have been attacked. There are few which are there publicly, the data is publicly available. There are few whose data is not publicly available. Majorly, it was either a malware or a ransomware attack which had happened. Now, what was the reason behind it? Reason behind it was an action taken by an employee in the organization. Now, why did they took such an action? If you look at the chronology, they took that action because they were not even aware of it. Why they were not aware of it? Because that awareness was not given to them that such an action can be taken. Hence, the importance needs to be given to the training to be provided to the employee with specific to the certain threats which are prominent and prevailing in the market today. Learning is one thing which we need to take from other organizations, from the threat intel feeds which we are getting, and accordingly we need to customize our training and emailers which will circulate to the employees in the organization. We need to ensure that at each and every stage they are well versed with the knowledge and be ready to take a corrective action in order to protect the organization. That would be my take, Deepak.
Wonderful. Now we'll understand from Mr. Milind Varekar. So he's from Saraswat Bank. Milind, if you can throw some light.
For the bank, cyber security or information security is from the two sides. One is from the customers that we need to be aware of their own personal security. And of course, we also need to take care of the security at the bank level. To take what Pawan has been saying, you know, perimeter security is not only sufficient. We need to ensure that the security of endpoints is also ensured. So when we are taking care of this at the infrastructure level, one more challenge remains is to make the each and every employee aware of his and her bank's entire security perspective. So they also need to be aware and they also need to be trained into taking care of their own personal safety as well as the bank's assets that they are handling. At the same time, during the pandemic also, most of us have seen that the attacks have increased, phishing attacks and all that. So you need to take care of all these things, as well as we also need to ensure that the customers are also aware of taking care of their own banking transactions when they're doing. They also need to be more aware of how to protect their PIN, how to protect their card information, not share it on the social media platforms. Because we have seen that a lot of hacking has happened because of the ignorance of the customers. And then they come back to the bank and also inform the loss of their amount. But so we are taking care of this also. We are regularly sending awareness messages to customer. We are doing campaigns. But still, we see that the attacks are happening and people are losing their money. So they also need to be made aware that, and they also need to be aware that on social media, don't share your personal details.
Good. So now, Dr. Sindhu Bhaskar, how you want to address the issue? We cannot hear you, Dr. Sindhu.
What I feel that we have been negligent about all these things since beginning, because we were into the digital world and like a computerized environment and all, but we did not take full care of all these malwares and spams. And we try to be inquisitive about them and try to find out that what is happening, how we can try to fight it out, but not very focus was given to those things, because we were trying to be in the expansion mode of our computerized environment and our digital environment, because we have to remember we missed out on the industrial revolution like Europe. So we had to take a leapfrog to digital environment and computerized environment. So we were more in the expansion mode rather than the safe keeping and safeguarding of our technology. But now that focus has come, but still, as rightly said by other participants, that there is problem of budget, there is still problem of focus. We are not able to identify and do correct action at time. And moreover, when we see what hacks and what malware and these zombie bots and whatever are there in the market, they have been for X number of years. It is not that they have come out all of a sudden, like Emotet, which has just been taken, like busted by Europolis. You can see it was earlier a banking Trojan, and now it has, in present circumstances, it had got such a wide arena, and they were playing like anything. Then there are sexual sites and malwares which like incite you to get into something and get blackmailed. So all those are digital evils which have been coming out of our progression to digital progress. So we have to be very, very careful, and we have to give utmost budgeting and proper support and training and continuous work towards creation of antidote is very, very important in today's environment.
Good. So Kapil Madan, how you want to address this issue?
Yeah, definitely a cybersecurity continue taking central stage, there's no doubt. If I talk about, you know, associated risk, take example of any threat called ransomware. So India is second most targeted country for ransomware. The increase of approximate 40 to 50% in 2020 as compared to last year. So it is important that start taking cybersecurity seriously. It needs to move much beyond simple compliance and become one of the top agenda items. So cybersecurity is business risk, everybody knows, no doubt. So it's majorly depends on CISO strategy and preparedness to handle newer security risk. How can CISO play key role here to fill gap between business, technology, security? First is related to, you know, preparedness. Second, you know, is related to advanced tools, solutions with integrated capabilities of artificial intelligence, machine learning, and third, definitely strong governance. So we discussed about, you know, awareness, phishing, and I'm agree with all the participants. So we should come with the approach of, you know, single click awareness solution. So if any employee is getting any phishing email, how he will come to us? How he will inform to IT he's getting that phishing email? There should be a solution, one click solution, there they will click on that and IT will be informed to that. So this is my take.
Good. So now we'll understand from Upkar Singh. They are in FIS Global is into a different business. They develop the software and a backbone for the bank or BFSI. So Upkar, how you will position this issue?
Yeah, thank you, Deepakji. Yes, truly, you know, the cybersecurity is truly a central stage for, you know, any organization, and especially for the fintech companies, you know, like us, which are a global one. And the security for us specifically is, you know, twofold, basically, not only internal as well as external. The kind of risk and challenges are well communicated by other team members. But I would like to highlight basically how it is critical for a company or any service organization like us is that we are delivering software to the banking institutions across the world. The challenge is that the code we write, right? So it is at multiple levels. The security has to be inbuilt at multiple levels, not only as a batch processing or the batch scanning of the code. So when we, you know, went to the agile methodology of development a few years back, right, the security, this is called by the DevOps kind of environment. So after, you know, a couple of months, we observed that we have to build security in our DevOps process. So that's how DevSecOps came into existence. And what we found that even while writing the P code, you know, a piece of code by a developer has to think of the security from the beginning, right? So it requires a lot of process involvement, a lot of technology involvement, so that with clicks, they will get to know where they are going wrong, even the testers. So the roles were started merging. Even the developers were doing testing, tester were doing some development, and the security, even the deployment staff, release engineer were involved in that structure. So the whole culture we saw is emerging like as a security. So security in our organization is a very paramount importance, starting from the beginning. Not only physical security, leave it is important, but network security or software security or endpoint security during this pandemic situation, like, you know, so even you know, when we give the solution to the external world, right, you being a global company are also getting targeted, specifically targeted. And to safeguard that, because it is a direct hit to our PI, if suppose an FIS gets compromised for some reason, so its reputation across the world will be impacted. So internally, we'll have to be double sure on each and every aspect, be it a shadow IT, be it a cloud security, be it a endpoint security. So not only technology, what we see that also the processes are important, like the patching, right? The threshold value of 97% is mandatory at our organization, like all the patching system, vulnerability scanning and mitigation vulnerability is very much important, right? Like the evolution of the product also. Suppose we bought a particular product for malware, right? So you need to evaluate, and you know, if some product is getting redundant, you need to have a replacement of that, right? In last year, what we observed that there was a 30,000% increase of malware attack worldwide, right? So when we started evaluating the, what the solution we have, how it is impacted, we saw that our product is not exactly meeting the coming business requirement. So we had replaced our endpoint security with a product B with more you know, agile kind of features. So these evaluation, and when we, you know, what happens that in a development company, a security sometimes becomes a hurdle for the developers also. So they say that, so the culture has to be developed. What we have evolved, that we told internally to everyone, yes, user training is very much important. If someone has phishing, drills are very much important. And user awareness in a way that the culture is built up like the security is as simple as ABC, right? So people observe, okay, what is ABC? It is always be careful, right? So developer, while writing a code, need to be careful. tester while testing need to be careful. Deployment or release engineers need to be careful while developing an environment on cloud or local or at client side. So the IT persons, while configuring any infrastructures, need to be taken care of some of hardening or vulnerability steps. So it is a culture as a whole, I believe.
Good, wonderful info. So now I'll move to the second question. Like, what is your take on IT, ITS sector has been one of the prime advocates of digital adoption? This will start from whom? Again, Upkar, let's start from you. Please.
Yeah, Deepakji, you see, this is again an important, because IT, we belong from this sector, and it is as important as, you know, because of, the fintech company, you have to have a, you know, couple of things in place, right? So the IT, ITS sector basically has to see that the operating model is as I said, and you have to have a kind of organization which is called a unified organization. So you will have to reimagine your way of working across development, infrastructure, and tech solutioning to drive better and faster outcome, right, for our clients, basically, that is customer, right? So what we have done, we have identified ways to automate our efforts we are currently doing manually, right? So the modernized, the second one is the modernized architecture and the tech platforms, right? So any company like IT, ITS, or any server company, even in any company, had to design a modern technology architecture that could be omni-channel, headless, cloud-first strategy we adopted, API-enabled, microservice-based, AI-ML, analytics, AI-ops, and embedded security. Embedded security means the security is embedded into the codes. So which will become the standard next-gen architecture for an organization like us. And the third, I think, pillar, I would say, the tech innovation, right? Delivering the digital products. So you have to build a culture where the innovation as a service strategy we need to adopt, and identify the several builders like crowdsourced developer network, marketplace framework, which will is going to boost our internal innovation outcome while leveraging external innovation, right? You'll have to come up with a collaboration with like-minded or a startup kind of companies, right? And our company being, you know, we acquire a lot of startups also, so we have to acquire their solutioning as well. So the fourth is that application portfolio rationality, making it simplify, right? So we have created a working draft for future blueprint for a leaner, more focused and effective platform, right? So that is making it simplify so that our product to the customers are as per the emerging technology, as per the market value, and giving them an edge with the competitions.
Wonderful, wonderful. So now we'll understand from Pawan Chawla. So there also how they're handling the things at the Future General. Pawan.
Pawan Chawla. Yeah. I'm here, Deepak. I'm here.
Yeah, please tell. How you are handling this thing.
See, digital adaptations, they always take a center stage, and especially in this pandemic, it has become a priority. And everything, whatever solution you deploy, has to be customer centric. Else you will be out of the business very soon. Let me put it that way. The easiness and the effort, the vastness which you can provide to the customer needs to be taken into consideration. But with that, you should not forget that what the technology you are implementing, the security has to be embedded in the system. And I completely second thought of Upkar, what he said when he talked about ABC. And I'm definitely become a fan of ABC now. That has to be definitely taken into consideration at all stages and need to be taught through to each and every individual in the organization before adopting a new technology, implementing an implemented technology, and supporting a new adaptation.
Good, good, good. Now, how Kapil will see Kapil Mehrotra? Kapil, you are there? You're not there?
My thought is like very straight in this. Digital is a need, and there are two segments which we have to always remember. One is the startups. Other one is the companies, those are running business from the ages, right? For them, digital objectives are totally different, because startup, generally, they are the disruptors and they are very early adopter. They come with the digitization idea. Because they know the pace and they know the market very well. And if you talk for the IT companies, giant companies, which are already there, they need a lot of changes in the system because they are running legacy systems and they cannot basically expose entire thing on a, you know, world. That's the big challenge, because some of the application, they are not designed in a way for the web can be used. So they have to do a lot of effort. And whenever we talk for readiness of those things, it's not only they have to change in the application, they have to change in the architecture, they have to change in the, you know, database architecture, they have to change in the security architecture as well. Because earlier applications were not thought through, they were not having a lot of, you know, security implementation. But today, if you see the kind of a vulnerability are hitting, right, there we have to have, always remember, whenever we are making any application or migrating any application on a cloud, or we are building a new strategy, right, in premises strategy, always we have to think like to rewrite the code in a way so that we cannot be vulnerable. So we have to always remember, we should not skip these parts, these aspects. Second thought is very important. Whether I need digital strategy in my organization or not. Because if I see so many organizations, they're thinking, I'm using this word, thinking, but are they really need that? Because some of the organization, they don't require digital. Some of the, but everybody is talking digital because they want to increase the footprint. Okay. So there are two aspects. Again, if organization is thinking towards to increase the footprint, are they really thinking in the terms of the acquiring customer or branding or the revenue, increase in the revenue, right? So there are a lot of things. Accordingly, you have to invest in your plan, right? So digital, whenever we talk for the digital, my point is, before that, there is a point called strategy. You have to have the business strategy in place first and then think about the digitization. Be it, it is IT/ITS or financial company or any organization. This is what is my thought process is.
You are absolutely right. We do agree with you. Now I'll understand from Dr. Sindhu Bhaskar, he's a global person. What is your perception at the global level? And you also come to India and explore things. What the difference of set of opinion when you be in US, Germany or India, what the difference you find?
See, first of all, I don't agree to the term disruption in technology. Because for me, if you see the history and the evolution of mankind and evolution of technology, every new technology displaces the old one. So every technology in one way is the disruptor. But I think it is just the evolutionary part of our system that keeps on creating a new one on the basis of our efforts that we have been putting and as a result of our past performances. So for me, these whatever we are having now, the fintech revolution, digital revolution, it is all part of our earlier efforts. So now moving with that, of course, I have been creating my digital banking in different countries, but overall the needs of human beings are the same everywhere. So what I first started at, I very correctly agree with Mr. Kapil that we have to have an agenda, a thought, a basic plan. Why do we what do we basically want to do? So just we are trying to enter and be part of the digital atmosphere, or we want to contribute. So that's how we created our organization and our banking setup, that, okay, why we are going to set up this bank. Bank means it has to assist the development, the economic process, the financial process. So we thought of that agenda, that bank should be the focus of development. Now, when you are taking it as the focus of development, you have to have interaction of all possible departments. Then only the integrated effort can lead to an integrated development. So we, from there, we borrowed the concept of integrated development. Now, when you have integrated development, you will definitely try to link it to all other paraphernalia, not only the financial aspect of banking, but the social aspect of banking, cultural aspect of banking, industrial aspect of banking, all those things. So that's how I try to give a composite culture to my digital banking. So now my banking is looking after not only the financial needs, but also the development needs. So I have the smart agriculture also there. I have Industry 4.0 also there. I have banking also there. And I have all the fintech aspects and all the digital aspects like blockchain, distributed ledger system, wherein we are doing all the settlements, trade settlements. And since I have different licenses in different countries, so I have connected it to one native blockchain. And we are trying to do all the settlements and everything on that blockchain. Then only we can go ahead and talk to other banks for integration. In Africa, what we are also offering, that small banks and weak banks who cannot sustain the expenses of these technical developments, they can get connected to us and become part of our ecosystem for the purpose of settlements. So all those things we are trying to develop only because we are trying to push bank as a source of development. Because with the start of fintech revolution, everyone thought that bank is the biggest evil. Whereas I think that bank is not the evil, bankers are the evil, because they have totally corrupted the whole system. So we had to, as a matter of fact, in so many speaking assignments, a couple of these millennials, they said, okay, but you are our enemy. So Mr. Enemy, how? I said, why do you think I am your enemy? Okay, the institution has done something wrong, some wrong decision. But what do you think in crypto world? Are you going to take some other route? You are also following the same economic principles which banks have been following. You are also fallible like other bankers. And you will see in the days to come how you are going to fall. So don't worry about that. All the plus minus of the past is same in the future also. It is only how we are perceiving them and how we are treating them. So that is how I have done my treatment of these perceptions, and I have tried to integrate to my system. And what I find, that if you have interoperable system and interoperable technology, it can get integrated to other systems and they can survive and they can contribute as well in any system, in any country.
Okay, Dr. Sindhu, okay. Now we'll understand from Mr. Milind Warikar. So he's heading the Saraswat Bank. Let's understand from Mr. Milind.
Sorry, I, because of the connectivity issue, I missed some part of it in between. Dipakji, can you please repeat?
What is your take on IT/ITS sector, which has been one of the prime advocates of digital adoption?
Well, when we are engaging with IT/ITS sector in two ways. One is we are taking services from them, as well as we are also taking products from them. So the IT/ITS sector, we have seen they are early adopter of digitization. And it really helped during the pandemic situation, because they could continue to give remote support, secure support. Some of the products which we have been using, some applications which were legacy applications, and when we also wanted to go and build in security features into that, like encryption at the data level. So they could really come forward and provide all those facilities, because not only the banks have woken up, but the regulator also is now insisting on the various adoption of security measures. They have a year back, RBI has issued a cybersecurity framework within which we need to have a graded approach to the security and implement. So it's not only applicable to us, but it is applicable to our business partners who are into fintechs, who are fintechs, as well as in IT service provider sectors. So we have also gone back to them, we have spoken to them, and they are also upgrading. They also have upgraded their systems. They are providing those secured services now. But as Dr. Sindhu said, you know, it has to be an entire ecosystem upgradation where not only the endpoints at bank levels, at the service provider levels, at the customer level also, they are need to be a part of the security framework.
Okay, fine. So now we'll understand from Kapil Madam. Kapil.
Yeah. So now if we'll talk about from industry, manufacturing, automobile, automotive, so industry 4.0, or we can say IoT. So these are the, you know, digital transformation, digital adoption, these organizations are, you know, getting. So that question you asked, so there is no doubt IT, IT sector has been one of the prime advocates of digital adoption. IT sector also pre-arranged digital transformation as like industry 4.0, IoT, to other sectors, to manufacturing sectors, to automobile sectors, other sector given, you know, vision, and IT sector transformed and positioned those to on ground. As you can see, adopting to the latest technologies is extremely important from both point. The first organization standpoint, other from customer's perspective that we discussed. So digital adoption has taken a quantum leap at both the organizational and industry level, and in last supporter is IT, ITS sector.
Okay, wonderful. So now we'll move to the next question. When we speak of digital transformation, which is important, vision or technology? Dr. Sindhu.
See, borrowing the term used by Mr. Upkar, we are in the stage industry 4.0, society 5.0, agriculture 3.0. If you put banking on that scale, and I have tried to grade it, we are at 10.0.
Wow.
Okay. So that is how the gradation goes. In my next book, I am giving all those things. Now, all these numbers, what does it suggest? Our development is uneven. And our technology growth is also uneven in different sectors. We don't have a composite growth. And that is the basic dilemma of our society and technology and everything, that which way we should go. Until unless we have a comprehensive whole, which is contributed by all the parts of the society, we cannot have the end result. So technology is the means, but where we have to go is our goal, our vision. And what vision is that? UN is defining it by SDG, all the 17 aspects of that. So those are our basic goals. To achieve them, we are using all these technologies and all. So I feel digital transformation, fintech revolution, industrial revolution, whatever revolution you name it, it is only for the betterment and comfort of we human beings and to make our life easier. That is the net goal. And we have to stick to that basic agenda.
So you mean to say the survival for the fittest, for the technology people's
not there? Survival of the fittest. It is an ecosystem wherein everyone has to contribute. Whole, like the sum of whole is greater than the parts. So that is how we have to contribute. All of us are parts of the system. We will contribute to create a greater whole. And that means human benefit.
Okay, wonderful.
That is where we are, what we are trying to do. And when we talk of artificial intelligence and machine learning and robotics and all that, then you are passing on the control to machines by machine learning and all that. I don't think we can survive with all those things. Ultimately, you will put a full stop. Okay, enough is enough. Like in abortion, you have so many views, whether to allow abortion or not to allow abortion. Then there are other, like even in Hindu society, we had sati system and all that, but we tried to put a full stop. That, okay, so the same way in our march of technology, I think we'll come to a spot where we'll say, okay, enough of automation. Now let us have some sort of humanism also. So that is where we'll be ultimately
going. We're listening today, we have heard a news by the big one of the biggest IT company. Automation has, we have increased our business, but automation has killed the manpower. For thousands of manpower they have to remove due to the automation. So with this backdrop, can you understand more from Upkar? Upkar?
Yes, Deepakji. Yes.
Yeah.
Very true.
What Deepakji. Is your view?
Yeah, actually, see, you know, vision and technology is a very pertinent, I think, subject in digital transformation, basically. When you see what I see in fact is that it is technology, vision, and then technology. How? See, digital transformation basically looks for a better result or better outcome, right? In perspective of the competitions, right? So when you have the knowledge of technology, that is emerging technologies, right? You can build a vision for the better outcome, right? So having a vision, then you can apply the same technology to having an outcome. For example, let's say technology per se, right? So when you know there is a knowledge of cloud as a platform or a technology, you can build a vision like that you will have a cloud SaaS, that is subscription-based consumption integrated solution for your deliverables to the client, right? This could be your one vision. And the outcome will be platform modernized, right? And E2E delivery, right? Expected. The other vision could be optimizing cost to deliver and service. So the outcome will be technology efficiency. Likewise, in operation, suppose we have a vision of centralized and scaled operation, right? So it will, outcome will be the accuracy through automation. Automation will have to come by application of technology, higher efficiency, right? You will do a risk profiling reduction. And when the high degree of automation and data analytics is involved, you can automate 50% of your business and IT operations, right? So likewise, in enterprise optimization, the vision could be optimize and create scalability to minimize cost and friction, right? So where the outcome could be vendor 5 to 10%, as he was mentioning, the reduction of the workforce and optimize the workplace also, the process reimagining. So I think technology, knowledge of technology, then vision, then application of technology resulting to the better outcome is the view I have.
So Kapil, do you agree with this? Kapil Mehrotra, do you agree with this, the statement of Ishukka?
I have a little different view because recently I undergone one of the training program of digitization. That changes my entire perspective. I'm not contradicting it, but my thought is a little different. Reason is because I'm giving you a very simple example, very basic. Everyone is working in a corporate and everyone must be going under to the town halls of the CEOs, right? What CEO says in the town hall? He says all his vision. This number, that number, we have to achieve it. This goal we have to achieve. That's our KRA, right? So I would say, if you're not having vision, you cannot plan it for the technology. Technology comes always after. But first, you should know करना क्या है, what we have to do. If our vision is not clear, we cannot basically build a technology roadmap. And I'm slightly giving you a couple of examples. One of the thing like, let's take example of a customer experience. If I want to basically make better customer experience through the digital technology, so what would be my vision? Should I bring the technology first or should I bring the vision first? Okay, so first of all, we have to target it, what problem statements they have, right? I will go to the deeper in the operation, pull the threads, what problem are those experiences are impacting to my brand? Are those problem statements are impacting to my revenue? What is the main cause of it? Accordingly, I will think about the solution. Is if I want to make a better customer experience, so I may think about, okay, let's have the real problem statement or direct feedback from the users. I will make a application which will take the spontaneous feedback from them, and then resolution of those, right? Problem can be anything. I'm giving a very basic example, very, very basic example. So these are the things which we have to always take. Vision come first, and then you can embed the technology according to your vision, right? That's what is my thought is.
Good. Now we'll understand from another Kapil, what is his views?
Yeah, I completely agree with Mr. Malhotra. So okay. My view, I'll say vision is much important than technology. Both are important, but in the race of vision and technology, vision will be on first position, then technology. This is my personal view. And successful digital transformation requires a clear, concise vision. And sometimes people try to do a, vision statement like a mission statement. That's not what I mean here. So the vision is the clear picture of what the future looks like. And technology, what drives digital transformation? A key element of digital transformation is, of course, technology. Technology is the tool that allows us to get the job done. Technology is a delivery agent, a solution, or what we call a cause in the machine. And then, technology provides a solution to a problem. Technology gave us the means. That's what we want to do. So my take here, vision is important for us.
Now we'll understand from the banker, Mr. Milind.
Yeah, most of the things which my fellow panelists have said are true. See, vision and technology, I feel, are interdependent. And along with that, I also would like to add one more element to it, is willingness to invest. See, you may have a vision and you may want to have a utopian state, and you also would like to adopt the technologies and customer experiences to improve that. But there has to be also willingness to invest in that technology and take it further. You may do it in a phased manner. You may not be able to adopt all the technologies that you want to be capable of taking your vision forward. But that willingness has to be there. You will define the vision. You also will have best of the technologies to use as a tools to implement that. And you also need to be willing to invest into those technologies. That is what my take is.
So it seems Pawan will have a different approach. Pawan Chawla, can you have your input, Pawan?
So approach is not different. It's just in a different interpretation. Vision.
Yes, okay.
Vision has to be supported by technology.
Do you agree with both the Kapil?
Yeah, I agree. I agree with Kapil Manotra. I agree with Kapil Madan. Both have said the same thing. The vision has to be supported by technology. Without each other's support, nothing can be achieved. I can have a vision of building a Taj Mahal, but I need to find a Mumtaz as well. No? You can't build that, right? So okay. Without that, you can't do it. So that way, whatever you want to do, so your vision is customer first, and to ensure that the customer comes first, you need to find a technology to ensure that whatever easiness you can bring in a customer life, that has to be adopted by the organization. And to adopt that, you need to have funding, you need to have finances backing the vision, backing the core of what you want to deliver to the customer. Vision will give you help you define the strategy for the organization. Basis the strategy, you can implement technology. With the help of technology, you can give better customer experience to your users.
Okay,
that's how I take it.
Okay, then now you tell me, Pawan. So, like, what are the key technologies and trends your organization is going to focus in the rest of the year?
From customer perspective, definitely there has to be easy provisioning of delivering of policies and whatever we can be given in hand to the customer without even getting into too much of hassle. So digitization is one thing which we already talked about, but now there is no paperwork required in the policy. So we have started delivering policies over the email as well. And thanks to the regulator who are supporting us on those matters, because earlier it was not that kind of a provision which was there. Now it has made provision and COVID has helped us in expediting that. So those has become prime focus for us. Second, with the delivery of policy, the certain things which customer used to visit the branches, customer used to go to the branches, customer used to call up, send us email, send us physical documents, those have become digitized now. Giving you an example of video KYC. So you don't need to submit physical documents for that. Now you can get into a video KYC and get the things done. Similarly, delivering. So with all these technologies, the security has to be with the paramount center of all these technologies, whatever we are deploying need to be factored in. So in the coming future, since the parameters has changed, the focus has to be given to the endpoints now. Which was never used to be the prime focus for any organization. So whatever changes are happening on your endpoint, whatever data is there in the laptop of users, that has to be secured in all the aspects, which was used to be one of the consideration, but never prioritized in the past. But that prioritization has to be brought in. So encryption is one thing which I'm definitely looking forward to, is going to be the prime focus. EDR is another technology which needs to be very importantly factored in, because the changes which are going to happen in your endpoints, you will never come to know when you're sitting at home unless the machine coordinates with your center, the server. The other technology which I could think of is from a traditional thing, most of the things will go into the cloud now. We used to have physical devices for certain things, for example, IPS IDS, for example, proxy. So those has to be moved on to the cloud for a better improvement, better enhancement, better delivery of services, not only to your employees, but for the ease of the organization as well. Management in the investment on physical infrastructure, I would say, is going to come down, but the investment on cloud is going to increase now with the change which has brought in.
Wonderful. You have given a very wonderful. Now we'll understand from Milind Parikar, how you see your bank to transform.
Deepakji, currently we are under migration phase. We are migrating from our homegrown core banking system to Infosys Pinnacle. Apart from that, we are also building up a lot of resilience into the infrastructure from cybersecurity point of view. We also have gone on to the hyper-converged platform. And taking it forward, this is from the infrastructure side. From the customer side, if you see, you know, for a customer now, the lines are blurred. Whether we are a cooperative bank, we are a private bank, we are a public sector, their expectations are same. So we are building up the applications more and more user-friendly. Our thrust henceforth would be to look at more of mobile banking applications to provide more and more facilities into mobile, because that is what people are looking at to use the facilities into the apps. They want to use banking as and when they require, wherever they are. So that facility we are building up more. At the same time, we are also doing a lot of automations. Like we said previously, we are adopting video KYC to onboard the customers remotely also, which will help in acquiring customers more faster. Though we have eKYC, and all those things. But still, we are building a video KYC as well. We are also integrating with fintechs, and we are looking at enabling API banking more and more, because that will give us help us to adopt customers for even our retail loan products, so that online retail loan disbursement and acquisitions can happen, as well as due diligence of the customers can be done using the services that these fintechs offer. So this is what we are looking to do.
Good. Now we'll understand from Ukar.
Yeah, Deepakji. So there are two approaches. One for the internal, the infrastructure or the operational, basically. So that is that we are in a process of integrating all the internal tools, right? So that we can make a data-driven approach and for the long run, like, the security solutions or a SIEM solution or a ticketing solution or asset management. So the data is centralized or in a lake, so that the all the tools across the globe can be leveraged for better decision making. So that is one process is already on. So for that purpose, we are using like EDR solution or refreshment of solutions, depending upon the business or compliance requirement. There are few obligatory requirement as well. So that process is already on. And from the external side, if you see, when where we are delivering our products to clients, so there we have no code, low code development platform we are working upon. In cyber threat management into our code we are working on. AR VR solution on the banking side we are working on, and like a DLT system on the blockchain that is in the progress. Even the machine learning from some of the fraud detection, though the solutions are already there, but we are leveraging it to the next level kind of thing. So these things are already in progress.
Wonderful. Dr. Sindhu, how you are going to address this situation?
As I earlier said, that I am focused towards development banking, and my digital banking is meant for development. So I have specific agenda on which I am working, and I'm just trying to achieve that. First is, of course, because 4 or 5 banking are getting connected to our own native blockchain. So I'm very focused on AML and KYC part. And I'm trying to have multi-factor authentication with open banking digital identity system, so that whatever banks are connected to us, we can facilitate the KYC in a very open manner and transparent manner. The second thing is, since all my banks are located in different countries, so I'm again taking care of data localization, that how we are going and where we are going to retain the data. Of course, cloud is one thing, but we are trying to have local data storage system, so that we don't come into conflict with any government. We want to be playing very, very safe, because our agenda is different, development, not fighting with government or any other issue. Third is a lot of emphasis on analytics, because we are into microcredit and all. For 2 years already, we have done the run in India, and it has given us good return also. My basic agenda is to reduce the interest rate. And for that, I have to have a very, very strong analytics, because I was telling everyone that the way microcredit is happening in India, it is going to crash. And you can see what is happening now. RBI is going to make a check and all that. You cannot substitute traditional landlordism by technical landlordism. This is what we were trying to do. So all these things are never, ever going to succeed. Because digital revolution and financial evolution, you are not trying to create a profit structure for yourself. We have to see how we are trying to cater to development. What is the applicability of all these fintech innovations that we are creating? But that was missing, because our agenda is still, we are moving on the elitist structure and whatever we are talking of, it's still above that level wherein we have to really look at. Like in the smart agriculture, I am not, you won't believe, but Deepakji, I'm taking some more time here to explain.
Wait,
you won't believe that some 1.5 years back, I had created a company, EST Cashless Grameen Mandi in India. I got it registered. I never knew that government will come out with this regulation, because this direct delivery and direct marketing of agricultural products, wherein even the logistic problem is taken care of, if we have that sort of modus operandi and that sort of apparatus working there, it will be a great thing. In 2019, July, during one CNBC interview, I had announced the concept of rural exchange. And in 2019, December, Reserve Bank and Stock Exchange of India did a symposium on rural exchange. Okay, that all those things kept on opening my way. So for doing anything in India, I don't need any like licenses and all. And because my concept of development was that the bank has to create that infrastructure to create that wealth, which can be circulated for further wealth creation. Because we are living in the age of donation, charity, subsidy. We are not getting over that. Until unless we create the mechanism to have wealth creation in these areas, we cannot have the rural development. So my focus of banking is in those areas. And that is exactly what I'm trying to do. Of course, people try to vilify me also, that how can you work like that with such agenda? You don't have any spread and all. So my banking model, which I have devised and which I'm, everything is getting launched one by one. So I have three verticals. One is the banking vertical, wherein, again, bankers or even digital architects will think that I am talking bullshit. But I am talking of also this tier one capital, tier two capital in digital banking, okay? Because for me, without recourse, there is no banking. So you cannot have a banking without recourse. So we have to have something. That is why I don't favor cryptos, because they don't have the recourse. Even I don't favor Bitcoin for banking, because it doesn't have the recourse. Yes, it has a great emotional connect, great emotional value, but real asset quality is missing there. So if we are going to have a crash like 2008, which government is going to support us? No one. So what will happen to the economy, we can understand. The second vertical that I've created is the development agenda for the banking. And the third is the revenue model, wherein I have different gamings and all that. I have a company registered in Singapore, which is called World Trading League. So we are launching their crypto trading league, but that is not a crypto trading, that is a mock crypto trading. So that those are revenue creations from those companies. I can pass on the benefits to the real banking, and the interest factor which goes high, that can be reduced. Because I'm trying to fix that interest factor at 10% for my microcredit. Right now it is looking like a very, I should say, improbable target, but it is not there. I have come up to 14%. So another 4% and I'll be fixing it at 10%.
Good.
That's how I'm trying to work it out and try to create the focus centers for my organization. And after analytics, the last one is the decentralized model. So I'm focusing more on POS models, point of services, because in my banking also, I have agent structure that provides the employment opportunity. So you will see all those things. I have to see if I am doing one thing, how I can cater to the development of that particular area, that particular country. So all those factors are weaved in to create a composite banking culture.
Good. Thank you, Dr. Sindhu. Now we'll go to Kapil Mehrotra. Kapil.
Yeah, thank you. Can you repeat your question?
Yeah. What are the key technologies and trends your organization is going to focus in the rest of the year?
So there are three things broadly we are focusing on. One is, of course, AI ML, and wherein like we have a multiple warehouses and which we want to surveillance through the CCTV cameras. So without any human intervention. So what we are trying, because most of the CCTV cameras, they are capable enough to basically give the feed. So you have to write the, you know, some kind of algorithm within the parametering. So you have to define the parameters as well, so that any intrusion is coming in between during the, you know, off hours, or some of the logics which are not appropriate. So they will throw the alert. So this is the kind of intelligence we are developing right now. It is in a POC safe. Secondly, what we are doing is we are trying to basically create a 3D model of the warehouses for the capacity utilization. That's a very new innovation in this space we are trying to figure out. So what? So there are multiple ways. So one way we tried it, the LiDAR cameras, it's a German-based cameras. They are very expensive. What they do is whenever you install, they create a parameter of the complete warehouse. And then you can figure out what is the leeway and the gangway that you can skip it. And I'm giving you example. For example, 5,000 metric space you have, and where in leeway, and when you're minusing the gangway, so it is coming to the 4,000 metric ton space. So wherein it means you can only fill 4,000 metric ton in the warehouse, not more than that. But when you talk, how much is the space? 5,000 metric ton, right? So that way you can actually plan the business. When we learned all those things, so we realized it, okay, this is what we were missing it. That is why every time disconnects were happening, management was having impression, okay, this much space we have available, but when we have really installed the camera, which was giving the reality figure to us, this is the available storage what you have. Then I'm coming to the utilization, where then we have to put a technology which can tell us through the camera, it can read that, and then algorithm will run at the back end, which will tell us, okay, this much stacks are filled and this much stacks are free, right? So that I can sell this off like a Book My Show, where you can go and you can see there are space available, you himself are booking it. So similarly, we can probably innovate some kind of, you know, ways out, which can tell you, okay, this much is a space are available for the farmers. So like from the Kota or from the, you know, Ganganagar or from any places, people can basically park the commodity near the warehouse which is available. Okay, so that there will be less transportation cost they will bear, and proactively they can go there and they can store it. So this is what is the one thing what we are focusing on. Another thing, certainly we are focusing on the AI ML in the HR digitization space, wherein like we want to read the trend of the organization. Right, we are the 2,500 people company. So we want to really learn the trend of the employer. Are they happy or not? And if they are happy, so how long they can stick with us? What all the gaps they are, or what all the new changes they are expecting it? It's very difficult to talk or read about anybody's philosophy. But you can definitely read the data, what you have in the system, and accordingly, you can predict it. Okay, this month maybe appraisal is happened, so maybe chances are 5% or 6% or 7% employee may leave, so we should be ready with the backup. That kind of, you know, intelligence everybody is looking for. Otherwise it will be manpower directly hit to your business, and if your business get impacted, so your revenue definitely get impacted. There will be you have to fall in a delays and other stuff. So HR digitization, though we are under process of digitization, and now we are thinking one level up, where we are basically trying to help creating the HR models and the algorithms. What algorithms can support to the HR models? That is two things what primarily we are looking for right now.
Good.
We are working on one thing that is called behavioral biometrics.
Okay.
So that is exactly what I think you are talking of in case of HR management.
Sure. So probably I can connect with you off the line to have more details about that.
Yeah. That's the behavioral biometrics, because facial, fingers, iris, and all that. After that, it is the behavioral part of how they are going to behave and all that.
Correct. Not only that, I'm looking something at the to minimize the attrition level of the organization, actually.
Right.
Okay. So now we know that automobile industry is very disruptive. Okay. So now every new technology, they want to put tried or tested automobile. Let's understand from Kapil how his organization is ready to do with the changes. Kapil, Madam.
Yeah. So our focus will be more to provide secure environment to all our employees. You know, after that, they can only focus on the organization business goals. If we'll provide secure environment, means everything will be secure and definitely will increase or enhance our business. Then after, my take integrated security solution with inbuilt that we discussed AIML capabilities in becoming essential for cybersecurity for business. So it will provide power to minimize risk, capabilities to fill security gaps. So our target will be, you know, adopting new technologies. So what will be these technologies? So I'm taking example from endpoint. You know, it will be, we will target to implement next-gen technologies to safeguard our endpoints, EDR, endpoint detection and response. Then in network security, we will target to implement advanced threat prevention tool and technology. Then after data protection, so organization data is very important. This is our business. Data is our business. So we'll try to safeguard data from human leakages as well as malicious leakages. So how competitor and other countries, so I'll not take name of any countries, how they are leaking data. So they are pushing malware there, and with the help of that malware, they are capturing data. So these types of leakages we want to stop. And definitely human leakages. So whenever any employee is leaving from organization, is copying all the data they are having. And after that, our target will be on application security from outer side. From external side, we are looking for web application firewall. It's already here, but the enhancement we are looking. And in last, the main key thing is cybersecurity assessment and compliance. So assessment is the main part where we are getting, where we are the weak, what are the risks are there. So our target will be more on assessment also.
Wonderful, Kapil. So you're right that there is a strong level of huge investment going into the EDR. Last week only, if I'm not wrong, the millions of dollars, the certain banks are investing into the EDR. But here, this is a good panel. We have a discussion. And I think nobody has spoke about the idea theft. So that will continue in our next panel. So thanks to panelists for sharing your valuable input. I would like to thank Kapil Mehrotra, Kapil Madan, Dr. Sindhu Bhaskar, Mr. Milan Warekar, Pawan Chawla, and Upkar Singh for sharing their valuable input. Thank you, gentlemen.
It was indeed a power-packed panel discussion session on the BFSI sector. Thank you, panelists, for sharing your valuable inputs during the session.